So glad that you're here to worship with us this morning. Please stand up as we begin our call to worship. To the weak who can't go on and need strength. To the wounded who are broken and long to be whole. To the wayward who are lost and far from home. We welcome you. We're glad you're here with us this morning. In Revelation, it says, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power, wealth, wisdom and might, honor, glory, and blessing." I invite you to join our congregation here this morning, to join the church worldwide, and also to join the angelic chorus as they sing out to the glory of our Savior.
And
Starting our time of confession, I want to read from Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin, for I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you and you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. We just take a time of silent confession, confessing sins, but also I feel like sometimes just a desire, asking God to renew in us a desire for holiness, a desire to walk upright in his way. We'll just take a time of silent confession. Join me in prayer. Lord God, we do love you and we thank you that you are our creator, the author of our stories and our lives. And God, we thank you that you are righteous, you are holy, and we thank you for the sacrifice and the blood of Jesus spent for us. And we thank you that if and when we confess our sins, you are faithful to us. You forgive our sins and you will cleanse us. I pray for each one of us here that that truth will wash in our lives and compel us how we walk, that we may walk rightly. In your Son's name, amen.
Praise the Lord. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. My name is Brian Hoover. I'm one of the pastor elders here at Community, and welcome to you today. I have the privilege of doing the pastoral prayer, so I would ask that you join me as we speak to our God. Our Father in heaven, we give you praise this morning. Lord, as we have sung just now, you are holy, holy, holy. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We're grateful for this. We're grateful for this standard that you have given. And Father, we pray that you would forgive us when our gaze falls from you, when it rests on things that are low and less than you. Lord, I pray that we would keep things in their right place, to be thankful for the good things that you've given us here, but not to have them elevate to a place that replaces you. I pray that we would see you as holy, 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 and seek to live our lives in a way that would honor and glorify who you are. Lord, I pray that those of us that are walking in faith through Jesus, that we would carry that message in all the places that we go. And as Susan had said, I pray that that would be the desire of our heart. And if it's not, Father, we ask that you would renew that in us this morning and throughout this week to come. We do thank you for the good things that you have given. We thank you for the ways that you have bless this local church through the giving of the people that are here, its members and visitors. Lord, we're grateful for that generosity and the things that that money can do, the way that it serves needs in families through the Benevolence Fund, through the Mission Fund, Lord, through the General Fund, all of the things that happen within this church. Lord, the good works that happen within here that you are bringing to these people, we're grateful for that and the way that that can be met. Father, I pray that the works that we would do would be the right ones, that you would give us wisdom in our heart to know what things we should invest our time and our energy and the money in that you give us. We thank you that you give us a vocation, a work to do throughout the week, a way to sustain our families. We're grateful for these kinds of things. Father, we praise you for this week that's coming up, this Missions Week, and all of the excitement about it and what it means. I pray that this local church and your greater universal church would carry out the mission that you have given, Lord, to just bring about the gospel to all the places of the world. And especially here in Harrisburg, Lord, I pray that Community would be a light here in this neighborhood. We want to lift to you in particular Neil and Tona and the ministry that they are doing here in Harrisburg. Thank you for their presence, their dedication to especially the refugee ministry, the immigrants that are here, Lord. Just the heart that you have given them and the way that they have sacrificed and the joy that we can see in each of them as they serve you and your people. Father, we thank you for our pastors, and in particular, we pray for Pastor Ron this morning as he's coming to continue to teach from the letter to the Corinthian church. I pray that our hearts would be open to the truth that he will bring, and that it would touch us and enable us to serve you better, to love you more deeply. We bring these things to you and pray them boldly in the Son, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, church. My name is Ilunga. I will be reading a passage of scripture today. Let's turn our Bible to page 896 Pew Bibles, and we will read 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10 to 23. You can follow on the screen as well. Let's read. According to the grace of God given to me, Like a skilled master builder, I lay the foundation and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest. For the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you thinks that he is wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is folly with God. For it is written, he catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile. So let no one boast in men, for all the things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all are yours. And you are Christ's, and Christ is God's. This is God's word.
Thank you, Ilunga. This time we can dismiss those who are going to be listening to the sermon as a second language down in the fellowship hall downstairs. And also the four-year-olds and kindergartners, you can be dismissed as well. I think Kira's back in the back waiting on you. So. Well, have you ever walked into a room and just ask, is someone burning something? Or was someone burning something? Maybe like when you have a match, right? You lit a match and you blow it out, or you blow out a candle. There's just that lingering smell that something was burning, that's no longer burning. Well, this passage kind of gives me the idea that when we get to heaven, we're going to be kind of looking around thinking, is something burning? Someone burning something? There's just this idea that there's going to be people in heaven that just kind of smell like smoke. Their works have been burned up. They were building the church with the wrong materials, and it did not survive that test of fire. Now, to be clear, in this passage, Paul is talking to Christians. Christians are the ones that are doing the building. And sometimes we as Christians just don't build the way that we should. We don't use the right material. We think too little of the foundation, which is Christ, and seek our own building constructed to what we think is right. Why do we do that? Why do we do that? Well, as we walk through this passage, let's use it as a way to examine the way that we are building, to allow the Holy Spirit to reveal to us the rotten materials that we are using to construct the church, or to be encouraged by what we do see, the good materials that we are using to construct the church. So let's use this as an opportunity to both be convicted and encouraged. Now, if you're here this morning and you're not a believer, I invite you to listen along, to see the beauty of Christ despite the brokenness of the church and the imperfect builders that we are. I know a lot of times when we think of non-believers and the reasons why they reject Christianity, it's because of the hypocrisy that they see in the church, and we don't want to deny that. Unfortunately, that is there. And perhaps this might be the sermon that you've been waiting on. It might not be delivered by the person you were hoping for, but it is the Word of God. We need to be careful the way that we're building. And so I invite you to listen along, to try to see the beauty of Christ, to look past us as builders, to look to the foundation. It's not His fault. It's our fault. So again, let's use this passage to examine how we are building. To help us with our examination, I want to really focus in on two questions. The first question is, how are we supposed to build the church anyway? I mean, what are the materials? And the second question is, why is how we build so important? Why is it so important that Paul would take time to specifically talk about this subject? And so, if we're going to do some examination, let's pause for a second and ask the Holy Spirit to be present to test our hearts. Lord, we do ask that you would be here through your word to test our hearts, to see if we are building in a way that's just not honoring to you. May we be ready to confess that and to turn things over to you, to allow you to build your church through us in a way that will bring honor and glory to you. And Lord, those areas where we see that we are building well, may we not grow prideful, but may we continue to strengthen those areas, to glorify you all the more in those areas. And so we ask that you would be present here in this moment to examine us and test us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you may remember from last week that Paul was talking about the building of the church, and he was using this metaphor of plants. And he says, you know, I planted, and then Apollos came along and he watered, but it was who gave the growth? It was God. It was God. We're nothing. It's God who gives the growth. And at the very end of verse 9, he changes metaphors, just like on the fly. He says, you know, you're God's field, God's building. And so that's where we're picking up the passage this morning, and we're going to focus in on that building. How are we supposed to build the church? Look with me again in verses 10 and 11. He says, according to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I lay the foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. And we find a very clear command in verse 10. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. Each one of us needs to take care how we build. And notice that I'm including all of us in this building project. The New Testament is very clear that every one of us who are part of the church has a role to play in building up the church. We have all been given gifts that we are to use for the edification and the building up of the church. So how we build is relevant to every one of us. But before we get to how we are building, maybe we need to stop even right here and just ask ourselves, are we building? Are we building? Am I building the church? Am I using my gifts and my talents for the construction and the building up of the church? Or am I allowing other things to pull me away from the building? Now, answer those questions, recognizing that each one of us are in different seasons of life. All right? So if you're at home with 3 or 4 small children around you, running around, you're not going to have as much time Okay, so it's okay. There's no guilt here. But the point is, with whatever time I do have, whatever time the Lord has given to me, am I using my talents and my giftings that He's given to me anyway to build His church? Now, the gist of this command in verse 10 is to pay attention. Pay attention to how we build on the foundation that has already been laid. Paul is very clear what that foundation is. It is Jesus Christ. If you remove Jesus, you no longer have a church, do you? Common sense. Take Jesus out of the equation, you don't have a church. So changing the foundation is not open for discussion. It's not an option. Improving the foundation is not an option. If we're going to build something that lasts, then we build on that foundation and that foundation alone. Jesus must be the center of all we do. Everything we do, everything we teach, everything we plan must be firmly attached to Him. It just should flow from Him. It should make sense. What we're building matches the foundation. You don't lay a foundation for a shed and then go and try to build a skyscraper on it. It doesn't make sense. You don't build that way. So even here we can stop and ask ourselves, does everything we do in our various ministries that we're involved in trace back to Jesus? Do the things that you plan as the various teams come from Jesus? Are they built on Jesus? So the foundation that Paul says we are building is on Jesus. Now we need to know what kind of materials should we be using in this building project. And so look with me here at verse 12, starting in verse 12. He says, now if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest. For the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. So notice that in this list, there's three things that are flammable and three things that are inflammable. And so I think the big idea is that there's a way to build that will last, that will go into eternity. And then there's a way to build that will not last. And every one of us will be tested. Our work will be put to the test by fire. Now it's important to note that this fire testing that he's talking about here is not a refining fire. It's not even the test of time. You know, so sometimes we say, well, only time will tell if that was a good decision or not. This is not even that kind of test. This is the test of the end of time. It is the final judgment. At the end of the day, there will be work that we have done that survives and work that we have done that gets burned up. And the difference between the work that survives and the work that gets burned up is whether or not we built with godly wisdom or worldly wisdom. Let's look at two verses to help us see this a little bit better. Look back up in verse 10. Paul says, according to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation. Now, I want to focus on that word skilled. Skilled master builder. That word skilled is the same word in the Greek that we see translated as wise down in verse 18. So jump down to verse 18. This is what Paul says there. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you thinks that he is wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may become wise. Wisdom will be used to build the church. The question is, what kind of wisdom? Is it godly wisdom, like we see in verse 10, that the skilled or wise master builder? Or is it the wisdom of this age, like we see in verse 18? There's a stark difference between the two. Ultimately, the church is birthed by the Spirit of God. And so if we are to build, we need to build with the wisdom that comes from God. And sometimes that's just going to run in direct opposition to the wisdom of this world. And you know that. You feel that sometimes. The decisions we make, it just seems to grate against what we see on TV, what we hear at work. And as we see here, if we truly want to be wise builders, we need to become a fool. A fool in the eyes of the world. And that's not pleasant either. Who wants to be a fool? Building with the wisdom of God means we build by His grace. That's why Paul says it's according to the grace of God given to him that he laid the foundation. It is God's grace that leads us, God's grace that empowers us. It is God's grace that we can understand how we build in such a way that brings Him honor. Building in this way, we are left with work that survives the fiery test to come. And we receive a reward. As I think about all the work that is being done amongst us in this church, I think there's lots of good ways where we see the building of God's church with these inflammable materials, with this gold and silver, precious stones, work that will last. I think of what's going on with the men's ministry and the discipleship that they're trying to cultivate. I think of the women's ministry and the mentoring and all the Bible studies that are going on. I think of the ELL classes that are taking place during the second service. People coming and learning a language, but yet learning about the gospel at the same time. All the kids' ministries, the youth ministries. There's lots of good things taking place. And we should praise the Lord for that. The wisdom of God is being used to build in lots of different ways. And building with the wisdom of this age is a total different ball game. Total different story. So what does that look like? Let me suggest three ways that we might see this wisdom of the age today. The first way is just putting all of our eggs in one basket. And what I mean by that is just depending on one person. I think this is very apparent in the context of these verses. The Corinthians were more concerned with following one person, be that Paul, Apollos, or Cephas, instead of following Christ. And perhaps the reason, what seemed at least wise in their eyes, is that the particular person they followed showed signs and giftings that would help the church grow. Maybe some of them came to know the Lord under the ministries of those various guys. And so they felt a sense of loyalty. But whatever the reason, it didn't lead to the building of the church. It led to divisiveness. And have you ever tried to get a project pushed through or build something when the whole team is divided and the whole team thinks they know the best way the project should be done and carried forward? There's not much growth. There's not much completion. And if there is, it's very hard-earned. That's not the way the church should be built. What the Corinthians were missing was the wisdom that was from God. If they had built with His wisdom, they would have realized that they didn't have to choose among these star leaders, let's call them, in the church. They didn't have to choose. Look down in verse 22, or 21, sorry. So let no one boast in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all are yours. And you are Christ, and Christ is God's. God, in his wisdom, were using all three of these men to build his church. They could have enjoyed the fruit of the Spirit's work in all three of these instead of just jealously trying to guard the reputation of one man and boasting in him. Watch out in elevating one person above others. Unfortunately, I think we see this today in the church. Not here, but in the churches that we can look around. Sometimes churches are just completely built around one personality, which is typically the lead pastor. The whole ministry is anchored by him. It can also happen in more subtle ways. I know people who have turned away from the church because a pastor was caught in some kind of sin. Now, obviously, that's horrible. It needs to be dealt with. It's painful for us. But if we're looking to Jesus, our faith should not be shaken when people we love and respect fall away. And I know that just from personal experience. A pastor who had a very important role in my life split our church, divorced his wife, and walked away from the faith. It's painful. But I've got to look to Jesus. I'm not trying to build that one guy's reputation. So maybe as an examination question, ask yourself, are you building up the church or the ministry of just one person? Now, another way we could build by the wisdom of the world is to build in such a way that we think the work depends on us. This would be boasting in yourself. So maybe you're not boasting in another person, but maybe you're boasting in yourself. You elevate your own giftings to the highest level of importance. The giftings of other people need to be used to support what you're doing. Or, and perhaps worse, you don't allow other people to use their giftings. You snuff them out. You might lose control if you allow other people to be involved in the ministry. You become possessive of the ministry. You have to be involved with everything, because if not, it might not be done right. Well, Paul says in that last verse, you are Christ. You belong to Christ. You are his servant. And being his servant means that you're free to serve other people. It means the ministry belongs to him and not to you, not to me. You're free to follow his lead, even if you think there's a better way that somehow always involves you. So ask yourself, are you possessive of the ministry you are involved in? Or do you allow others to use their gifts in the building of the church? And one last way I think we could build with the wisdom of this age that I would like to mention, just because I think it's a little bit more tied to the day and age that we live in today, and that is by building, by looking for the fastest and easiest way to build. The fastest and easiest way to build. There's something inferred in these verses that building the church is no easy task. It's hard work, takes time. I mean, for example, Paul says that he laid the foundation and others are building upon it. He doesn't lay the foundation and then build in such a way that he completes and finishes the work. It takes time. Think about the main cathedral in Milan, Italy. It was started to be built back in the 1300s. And it wasn't finished until like the 1800s when Napoleon came into Milan and he wanted to crown himself as Emperor of Italy. And so he had him finish 500 years. Now think about that. How many master builders had to carry that work forward? How many architects had to carry that work forward? There wasn't just one person designing and then finishing the work. It's impossible. You can't do it. I mean, even the materials that Paul mentions here that are inflammable, the gold, the silver, the stone, it takes time to work with those. It takes a certain skill set. You can't get it done very quickly. The wisdom of our age is to seek the fastest and easiest way to build the church. It's the get-rich-quick idea of church growth. I know I faced that temptation when we're church planting in Italy. It gets frustrating. I mean, you're doing these events, you're doing the church services, and no one's coming. You talk to people in the street, and there's just a total indifference to the gospel, an indifference to Jesus. And so the temptation comes, well, let me just do a bunch of events to attract a crowd. Just let's forget the gospel. Let's forget anything religious. Unfortunately, we didn't fall into that temptation, but it's not easy. Now, unfortunately, I can look back on my ministry as a youth pastor. It might see a different story. I can think of a lot of things that I did during that time that would be building with wood, hay, and straw. Lots of events that just didn't have eternal significance. And there's nothing wrong with the pizza parties and going to the amusement parks, but when that is your focus, you're not building upon the foundation of Jesus. Unfortunately, we don't have to worry about here. Noah's got things in order. He's very thoughtful about the ministry he does. Sometimes building God's way takes time. Sometimes it is hard, and I don't think we really like that. So let's ask ourselves, are we willing to be patient in the building of the church? Are we willing to put in the hard work that it sometimes requires? Well, we could come up with a long list of all the ways that we could build with the wisdom of this age. But please recognize one thing. It's not always apparent. It's not always obvious. We need the guidance of God's word, and we need one another to help us see where we're building with the wrong materials. Each one of us needs to take care of how we build. We need to look. We need to observe. We need to be aware, always ready to learn. We need to direct our attention to the foundation. Let's not think too little of the foundation and seek our own building constructed to what we think is right. We must not lose sight of Jesus. That way, when the fiery test comes in that last day, our work will stand. Now, if it gets burned up, Paul says, we're going to suffer loss, though we ourselves will be saved, but only as through a fire. It's just like taking a burning stick out of the fire, just kind of smoldering, smoke coming off of it. You're going to be saved, but it's going to sin. Your work is going to be a loss. Pay attention to how you build the church. Now for the why question. I said there was two questions. Here's the second question, the why question. Let's just bring this all to a close as we consider why how we build is so important. Why is it so important? We could simply respond, well, because if we build correctly, if we build in a way that lasts, we get rewards. That's good. That's good motivation. Wouldn't be wrong necessarily. But it's not the ultimate motivation. There's a more important answer to the why question. Look with me again at verses 16 and 17. Paul says, "Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is holy, and you are that temple." The idea of the temple is something that would have resonated with Paul's audience. And be they Jews or Gentiles, it wouldn't matter. A temple would have been understood as the very dwelling place of their God. Now we know that for the Jews, this meant that Yahweh's presence would have been in the temple. And we learn in the Old Testament that God's presence was found in the most central part of the temple, in the Holy of Holies. His presence brought holiness. And for that reason, everything associated with the temple and all the temple service needed to be purified. It was set apart for special use and considered holy because God's presence was there. But notice the radical shift that Paul takes here. The temple is no longer a place to go to. He says, "You are that temple." That is, the church is God's temple. We are the dwelling place of God because of Jesus. Jesus entered into the Holy of Holies in heaven, made the ultimate sacrifice for us that we might be purified in order for the very presence of God to dwell in us. But notice, though, that when Paul says that you are the temple, that you is plural. So we need some good Southern here, right? Y'all are the temple of God. It's kind of helpful. Y'all are the temple of God. It's not singular. As we gather together, we are God's temple. God's presence is here. Now, I know that the wisdom of this age screams, but no, you as an individual are a temple of God. And there is truth to that. We'll see that later in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. But right here in this passage, Paul is putting an emphasis on the corporate nature of the temple of God. We are the temple of God. We together are where the Spirit lives. And that means there is an exceedingly high expectation of holiness. That's why how we build is so important. Build well. Build in a way that reflects the very holiness of God. Think twice before you build in a way that would bring dishonor, that would damage, or that would destroy this temple. Because Paul gives a pretty strong warning here. Those who would destroy God's temple, God will destroy them. That's serious. Don't destroy his temple. This warning's pretty strong. But I think there's also a level of encouragement there as well. And that is, God's watching over us. God loves his church. God loves his bride. He protects his body. And so if someone is going to try to destroy us, God says, "I got that. I'll take care of that." Let each one of us take care how we build upon the foundation that has been laid, which is Jesus Christ. Don't be misled by the wisdom of this age and think that you know a better way, because you don't. Build in such a way that allows people to see the very holiness of God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Well, Lord, we We confess that we need your help in all this. We need your grace, because it's only by your grace that we're going to be able to build. And I just pray again that as we reflect upon these verses, even this week, that you would bring to mind ways that we're not building well. And it may not be the worst thing in the world, but it's just maybe things we need to change, things we need to tweak. But at the same time, I pray for that encouragement. I pray that as we reflect on this and we see all the good work that is being done, we would celebrate that and we would give thanks to you, because that's only by your grace. So we thank you for that. We ask that you would be honored, that you would be glorified, and that people around us would see your holiness. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand. My eyes in wonder and shine. You may be seated.
Well, this morning you might be wondering why are there so many flags around, and next week you're going to see even more flags, but today we're kicking off a week-long of celebration, a missions and outreach celebration. Notice I did not say conference, okay? We're trying to say celebration. We want to celebrate what the Lord is doing all around the world and right here in Harrisburg through our ministry partners and also through us as a church. And so that's why the flags are here. We have a week of activities planned starting Wednesday, so not Monday and Tuesday, but on Wednesday and Friday we have some workshops so we can get some training in how to share our faith in a very easy, practical ways. And then on Thursday and Saturday, we have some opportunities to put things in practice, to go out and serve. Out on a table out in the lobby, you'll see a table with all the flags on it. There's some sign-up sheets for those various workshops and activities. There's more information about those as well, so I'm not going to go through all the times and whatnot right now. But please go over there, sign up, get some more information. If you do want to talk to me, feel free after the service. I can try to help you out as much as I can. And one last thing, we have produced a prayer guide this year. And you'll see on there it says Volume 1. Maybe there will be a Volume 2 later. Who knows? But this is just something you can use every month just to go through. There's like, you know, day 1, day 2, day, you know, and so forth. And on each day, there's some suggested prayer requests, or there's like a little biography of our ministry partners, or there's actually some interviews with some of you in this room. So you can read through that and use it as a tool to pray. Those are out in the lobby on the various tables and whatnot, so please pick one up and take that home with you. This morning, we're going to listen to our missionary spotlight, I think is what we call it. Our ministry partners, Neil and Tona Hess, are working right here in the Harrisburg area with the immigrants and doing lots of good work. Everywhere I go, I talk to different churches or different pastors or whatever. Everybody always knows about Neil and Tona. So that's a good thing. They're doing lots of good work that's going to last, and so we praise the Lord for that.
Good morning, church. My name is Jeff Davis, and on behalf of the Missions Committee, I have the privilege of reintroducing Neil and Tona to you. If you have walked the hallways and you have met some of the variety of folks that God has brought to our church, you probably have witnessed their ministry. Just a couple of questions to let you know where they're at right now and how you can pray. Neil and Tona, I'm wondering if you couldn't share a little bit about your call to ministry and tell us a little bit about where God has taken you over the last 29 years.
Okay, so I was born in Liverpool, Pennsylvania, which is about 40 miles north of here, and my wife was born in Norway. So how did we get together? So I grew up on a farm, you know, just a normal working person, learned mechanics and farming, and that's what I did. And sometimes through the ministry of a local church, I came to understand my need of a Savior. And, you know, the wife of the pastor took us up in the kitchen, you know, it was just a small church, and she taught us these Bible lessons, and I started understanding who God was and how great he was. But, you know, we had a problem. We had a sin problem that separated us from God, and there was nothing I could do to repair that. But she also took us through and showed us Jesus Christ, how God sent his only son to die for me. And that relationship could be restored if I just would believe what Christ did on my behalf. And I placed my faith in him at age 10 and started reading the Bible. But then there was times when I would follow my own path and get in trouble. And this went on a cycle through several years through high school and out of high school, and got myself in big trouble. And finally, when the Lord got a hold of my heart, you know, I just felt so convicted. And he confirmed to me my salvation, and I started living for him. I fell in love with his word, and he placed in me a desire to serve him. And I saw this pamphlet at church, and they needed a mission team to go to Greenland. And I just felt, you know, I need to go on this team. And God took me to Greenland, and the day after I landed there, that is where I met her. So you tell a little bit about you.
I don't know if this is exactly what we were planning, but anyway. So, okay, so I grew up in Norway, and I grew up in a church that didn't really teach a clear gospel. But my mom was involved in a mission organization, an evangelical mission organization. So I heard about missionaries. Sometimes we had them staying at our house too. And when I graduated from high school, I went to England for Bible college. And through that time, the need for missions around the world was emphasized a lot. And I learned that there are many, you know, unreached people groups in the world. And so then for me, you know, missions is kind of seeing the need. And God calls really all believers through the Great Commission to take the gospel and to make disciples of all nations. So for me, that meant to leave my country behind and to go to other countries. And I think for all of us, we need to, you know, just ask God, what does that calling mean in my life? So yeah, so our journey started together there when we went to Greenland. And after that, are you going to continue now? Mm-hmm. Or
you could say why you went to Greenland.
So then I heard about this team going to Greenland, and I thought that would be a great opportunity to explore that part of the world and the possibility of me going there maybe in the future. So I knew one of the women from Norway that had gone there as a missionary. So I asked if I could join that team going straight from Norway, and I joined up there. That was you.
So after that 5-week trip in Greenland, God started something in many fronts, and he challenged my heart into full-time service. Like, I knew God wanted me in full-time, and if he was the one that was leading me into this, he was the one that was going to give me the wisdom and strength to do that. And so we got married 2 years later in Norway, and we came to the States and took some mission training. And we went back to Greenland for 12 years in the role of church planting, ministering to kids club, youth, some community projects, and that kind of thing. After Greenland, we went to Missouri, where we were involved in training mission candidates. And we did that for 4.5 years. And then we felt God pulling us to Australia. There was a need there for a training center. So we went there, and during our time there, God also not only led us to some great people and some different work there, but also he took us to Nepal on a short-term trip, to the Philippines several times, and to Indonesia. And these places where there is some churches, but they wanted some help. And so we tried to be a part in the best way we could. But God was always faithful to us.
Could you tell us a little bit about the kinds of things that God is asking you to do here?
Okay, so when we came back to the States, we settled in the Harrisburg area for the specific purpose of working with immigrants and refugees that are coming into the area. At that time, in 2016, there was 300 a year coming in, specifically refugees, into the greater Harrisburg area. And so we were finding out where they were being settled. We started getting involved and helping out with that ministry. And it wasn't necessarily a religious organization that was set on the people, but we got to find out and be a part of that. And right now we're involved with that through helping with provide furniture and house settlement. We do paperwork, help them get the driver's license, their documents to live and function here, work permits, things like that. And also, we do a kids club. We do that sometimes in connection with the church here. Sometimes it's separate at our house or other areas, local parks and things. And our focus is on helping the children understanding the gospel, teaching Bible stories. And of course, we provide meals, we provide activities and things for the children.
What other things were there? Tell us a little bit about English as a second language and what you're doing with the English classes.
Okay, so we know that when you come new to a country, that learning English is like the basics you need for life in America. If you're gonna work and you're gonna be engaged with your kids in school and in the community, you have to learn to speak English. So this is really, I feel I've been burdened with this. It's a great opportunity for us as a church to reach out to people and to help them learn to speak English. And that's an opportunity for us to share our faith and to invite them into the community of the church. So when we first came to Harrisburg, I helped start up the program at Living Water Church, and also started teaching through the resettlement agency. And I have assisted some other church programs in starting up ESL classes as well. And another thing that I've been involved with the last couple of years is actually writing some workbooks myself. So buying good material is very expensive, and when you have volunteer classes that don't have big budgets, then it's good to have something that's affordable. So I have created a series called New in America, which are workbooks on all three levels. And then I also made a book that's called The Greatest Story, A Journey Through the Bible, which is going through the Bible for English learners on two different levels. And as you know, we have an English program here at our church. And for me, it's great to have our church be part of this. And so that's been kind of our desire the whole time, to do our ministry through the church and to see that our church here has been taking on this ministry, has been very encouraging for us. And now that we can do this English program through our church and to invite the students into the community of our church, that's something that's been on our hearts. And so during the summer, we prayed, or actually for a long time, we prayed that God will, you know, send more students to our program, and students that would be interested in not just learning English, but, you know, to learning about Jesus and be part of our community. And so we started in September, and now we have over 40 students registered in our program. And they are from Colombia, Venezuela, Ecuador, Mexico, Brazil, Nicaragua, Peru, Haiti, Congo, Niger, Togo, Gabon, Afghanistan. So we have a great variety of people here. We meet downstairs and in the cafe during the second service. And we have a great team of volunteers, but we welcome more helpers. And several now of our students are interested in having the sermon translated into their language. And we're praying for more of the students to be interested. Maybe we can start up like ESL Bible studies with them. And so that's what we're working towards.
Would you let me tell you, as a missionary from this church myself, that it's a tremendous encouragement to have folks who are willing to listen, who are willing to pray for Neil and Tona, to be involved in their ministry. This is something that you can do. We're looking for volunteers, folks who are willing to just spend some time sharing the love of the Lord Jesus Christ with folks who perhaps feel a little bit out of their element here. So would you pray with me bow your heads and let's talk to the Lord about the needs that Neil and Tona have. Father, pour out your grace on Neil and Tona. Pour out your love on them. Multiply it. I pray for the sacrifices that they have made in their personal lives for the sake of your children that are scattered around the world and have found a home here, have found a place where they can be loved and appreciated, and Father, where your great care is administered. I just pray for additional volunteers. Touch the hearts, the minds, the wills of people who are in the service this morning that you want to be a part of the prayer team or the financial team or to volunteer to be a part of these English as a second language clubs or the children's clubs. Father, bless this outreach as a part of the community evangelical free family. Help us to embrace people who don't come from the same background. Father, help us to show love to people that are sometimes difficult to communicate with. Help us to be the kind of church that you want us to be. I just appreciated the sermon this morning about how to build on a foundation that really has Christ at its center, and that's what we're asking for. And I pray this blessing over Neil and Tona and our church as a whole in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Thanks for listening, folks. Amen.
Well, thank you, Neil and Tona. Thank you. Well, would you please stand and receive the benediction? And you'll notice on the way out of the building, there's boxes at each door, and you can put your offering in there. But now, if you're a visitor, you don't need to worry about putting an offering in, but we would ask that you maybe fill out one of these cards so we can get in touch with you and just drop that into one of those boxes. And make sure you pass by that table with the flags in there that I mentioned and sign up for some things to do this week as much as you can, if any, it would be great. Let me read to you from 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. May you go serving the Lord this week, building up his church, his temple. Go in peace.